I'm going to focus on carbon emissions, the carbon emissions part of sustainable living, because it tends to be a good proxy for the whole ecological footprint, and because there is much better data for it, so I can quote a lot more data, and we can discuss whether you believe the data. I will talk about how much we'll need to reduce going from current living, current average UK living, to a sustainable level. And then we're going to divide things up to make it a bit easier: home energy, transport, food, and the indirect stuff. And look at some of the latest evidence, some of the scientific evidence, some of the measurements of our living, our lifestyles in co-housing here, some evidence from various other real life projects elsewhere. Supplement that with a few other studies and assessments from around the way, and then finish off by talking about, okay, is the sustainable lifestyle that I'm constructing from within the data contributing to quality of life? And I'm going to argue that there are clear ways that it is. So I'm going to talk about those at the end. We'll start off with how much we need to reduce. So the estimate of current emissions per person in the UK in tonnes of carbon dioxide equivalent, which is the standard measure for emissions of greenhouse gases, is about 12 tonnes. And that includes some of the indirect emissions, or a lot of the indirect emissions, from things like food and food grown outside the UK, and indirect emissions from goods that we buy in the UK but are manufactured elsewhere. So it includes at least some of those, and flying as well, which is also not included within the UK government data on carbon emissions. Or at least flying internationally is not included. So those all together is somewhere around 12 tonnes per person. If you look at some of the figures that Maria Shamina was talking about this morning, I'm trying to keep below 2 degrees, giving yourself 80% chance of keeping below 2 degrees. I've used the calculations done by the Centre for Alternative Technology in their Zero Carbon Britain report, and that's based on fair shares amongst all the countries in the world according to population, and a carbon budget over the next 40 years, or more specifically from 2010 to 2050. And that comes to about 3 tonnes per head per person. So that's where we are and where we're aiming for. And I'm going to look at these 4 areas. And I'm going to look at how much we might be able to do through our choice of technology that is around now, and how much we might be able to do through our choice of behaviour in amongst the options now. So some of the technologies I might talk about are expensive or need extra funding, but they're around now. They're reasonably possible. I'm not going to talk about future technologies. That's something that could help this, but I'm not going to go there at the moment. That's too speculative, I think. So I'm going to start with this estimate, which was by a researcher called Chris Goodall in a book called How to Live a Low Carbon Life. And that breaks it down into these categories, about 12.5 tonnes altogether. So you've got your heating, electricity, home electricity use, transport there, food there, and then various indirect effects, which is about the various less specific effects are about 40%. As Sue particularly talked about, that's there are some difficult issues there and they're not under your control. I'm going to talk about some different ways of maybe how you deal with that with the things that are under your control. And I'll talk about that towards the end. So I'm going to start off with home energy. And I'm going to go through each one and maybe we can have a little chat at each stage and see whether you believe some of the figures I'm coming up and some of the options I'm coming out with. And we'll see where we go. The first option, which is quite straightforward, it is the situation we have at Lancaster Cohousing, where we have passive house, based on a sample of the last year's energy bills, we reckon we reduce our energy use for heating and hot water bill about 85% below an average UK house. That's because we only have one radiator in the house that we only use a little bit of the year because of the super insulation, and the hot water use is reduced through having low flow taps, low flow shower heads, smaller baths, and so that helps reduce your hot water use. And then you've got energy supplied by sustainable biomass, the wood chip boiler there, which is sourced by a combination of wood waste from a local sawmill and wood chips from a sustainably managed forest, or forests in Lancashire and Cumbria. And then solar hot water panels on the roof, and then you've got electricity. At the moment it's from PV, supplemented by renewable energy bought through a renewable energy tariff, but from Christmas it will be from hydro. So through that, more or less, reduce your emissions by 100%. So that's kind of one example of major reductions. But of course that one's a difficult one, and that option isn't available.
Yeah,
part of it. That's on another slide, but yeah. The I should mention that this energy use includes the heating use in the communal areas as well, so a share for each house. So yeah, it's even lower if you just look at the house itself. That sharing aspect makes a big difference too. Okay, if buying a brand new passive house is an option that's not open to many, but something that's more open to more people is a major retrofit of your house to bring up the insulation standards, fit some micro renewables, so you've got wall loft. We had a discussion in the last session about whether floor insulation was worth it. But certainly some super homes programs. There's a very interesting database online of this program where they give details of how they've done retrofits in particular houses, brought their energy use down by an average of around, or carbon savings of around 70% based on the combination of these measures in different houses. So some bits, insulation is always part of it, and then you've got maybe solar hot water panels or solar photovoltaic efficient appliances, that's part of it.
Could I just ask one thing? Obviously, if you're going to achieve that 7%, it's good, but the UK target, in line with the EU target, is 80%. The deadline is far too late, it should be done now.
The target.
The 80% reduction is in greenhouse gas emissions.
Right.
Compared with 1990
By 2050. Yeah.
So the deadline is far too late.
Mm-hmm.
The amount may be too little.
Mm-hmm.
So on this, it's 70%. But if you take all the areas of the economy,
mm-hmm.
if one area has a shortfall of this target,
mm-hmm.
other areas have to make it up.
Yeah. Yeah.
Now, every area would say, oh, we can't do it.
I'll show you how these combine together and how some may offset another. I think I've not seen any good data that says you can consistently achieve carbon savings in a retrofit more than around 70%. In fact, some argue that actually 70% is pushing it. So, yeah, I take your point there. If we don't do it here, we've got to do it somewhere else.
We're trying to do this.
Major investment in renewables, substituting renewable forms of energy for fossil fuels. I don't think that's on.
Sorry, say that again.
Well, there are two approaches. One is indeed being more economical with the use of energy.
Yeah.
And I'm nothing against it. But I do not think we get anywhere unless actually also use the other route, reduce energy from renewable sources.
Yeah, both of those are there.
Yeah, but as a long-term option, this is 50 years, It's not good enough. We need to bring down the carbon content of the atmosphere as well. We need the technology, the high-grade technology in any case.
But I think, I mean, this is what this option is, and this is what, and I, again, I'm talking about what people can do on an individual basis, and I'll come to the wider economy has also got to change as well, and I'll talk a bit more about that. This is kind of approaching it from, okay, what does sustainable living look like? What could it look like that is appealing? What is? So there are smaller homes and sharing as other possibilities where you can bring, you can get greater reductions than other things. So yeah, not having lots of one-person households is a big thing. Sharing more of your stuff with your neighbours, car share schemes, car clubs, these sorts of issues. I mean, I'll come on to transport shortly. Putting these together, this is kind of the order of the savings, and this is average across the UK. Obviously, if you live in a big house and you're very wasteful at the moment, you can save a lot more of this by moving to a passive house. But this is kind of average figures. So you've, from your heating and your hot water in a passive house, you can get down above 3 tonnes. The whole house insulation retrofit, less than that, but still quite a long way. There's a bit more from more efficient use of houses through behaviour change, and then you've got your electricity use through efficient lighting and appliances and renewable energy like solar panels. And a smaller number of appliances, another behaviour change there can help you bring carbon emissions down further. So that's kind of... I'm interested whether you think those sorts of figures kind of tie up better, those of you who have particular knowledge in particular areas. Does that seem reasonable?
No, not really. One major problem simply that moving house is a major operation which people of my generation are not looking forward to.
Mm-hmm.
We live in a house we bought when the two kids were living in the house. We're not going to move. That is a major operation.
Yeah. Mm-hmm. I think that...
It's not only myself. I mean, the whole road is like that.
Mm.
A lot of retired people.
Mm. Yes, yeah. I agree, there are plenty of obstacles. I want to construct something that is appealing, that could appeal to a lot of people and say, actually, a lot of us could actually do this.
Because you can do the lodges.
Yeah. That's a good point. Taking in lodges is another way of using
energy. In terms of retrofitting of an old house, I was trying to get some of this Green Deal money to balance in about 3 weeks. Insulation, it's not stuff in the house, and it wasn't external insulation. But I had a Green Deal with a registered company, and they recommend that, you know, to do the insulation of the internal walls and all the roof area, because my bedroom was in one of those huge rooms, was plenty of insulation.
Yeah.
They gave me a quote of £16,000. Now, in the end, that money went, and I wasn't.
I mean, given the money aspect of it, it was interesting what Maria Shamina was saying about, you know, if we want to make the money available in the economy, there are ways the government could do it. And I think, during the last session, we talked about how bad the Green Deal was run, and there's a lot more potential there to do it a lot better. And I think skills, you're absolutely right, skills is a big obstacle. We were talking about this in the last session as well. But I think your point about, okay, I can make up for that by behaviour change is a very interesting one. Maybe that actually for some people you wouldn't go for that, you'd only go part of that and save maybe half a ton, but actually you're sort of turning thermostat down or taking in a lodger or some other aspect of behaviour change would be the bigger aspect. Well, this is it. You've got how many people in your household?
Well, depending on what your parents are there, it's between 3 and 5 of
us. Oh, well. There you go. You're much lighter than half the time.
Can I just say, sometimes it's not as challenging. I had to have a new kitchen fitted last year. At the same time, I got a new boiler. Combination and all my new, it's only a small kitchen, it was reasonably small house. But I did get a new fridge freezer, gas cooker, gas electric cooker, new appliances, and I run dishwashers and dishwashers. But at the same time, I changed my energy company from one of the big six, I've done it a couple of years ago. Literally overnight, I seemed to halve what I was paying. Mm-hmm. It went to half. I was paying £50 a month. After the refit, it went down to £120. But within no time at all, I was in credit. Mm-hmm. So I'm now only paying £84 a month. So it just opened my eyes to the fact that A rated, yes, it doesn't. Mm-hmm. And more than yes, it does make but it's probably not the best way of doing it in your terms. Mm-hmm. But it did make a heck of a difference in my budget.
Mm-hmm.
So it's not hard to, I haven't had to do much in my behavior.
Well, I think this is it. It's kind of, I mean, I'm trying to get down to 3 tons, which is hard. There are a lot of simple options that maybe will get you down to 6 tons, which actually aren't that expensive. I set a harder challenge here because of the imperative that we talked about this morning. Given where we are, there's still a lot of easy stuff that can be done.
Modernising does help. It pushes up pay for residents. It's not cheap to get new stuff, but at the end of the day, I'm putting my money back and I feel easy about it.
Okay, let's go on to transport. Fun. The easiest thing on transport is just stop flying. That's average annual flying is equivalent to about one return flight to Rome. And not doing that will save you about 1.2 tons. If you're doing something longer, like one return flight to Washington, D.C., that's equivalent carbon emissions to the average home's energy use for the whole year. So, flying is big. It's big, and not doing it makes a very big difference. And I know it's difficult sometimes. I kind of find it easy now. I gave up flying quite a while ago. And my dad works for British Airways, so it was an interesting family issue. Yeah, love miles, travelling to meet family. Yes.
Can I correct myself again? If you're not going any further than Paris, it's quicker to go in through tunnel than by airplane.
Yeah.
I mean, the check-in now at Jakarta at the airport is about 2 hours, whereas at St. Pancras it's 20 minutes.
It's travelling in and out of the centre as well. If you live near Heathrow, obviously it's easy, but if you live in the centre of London, it's easy to get on the train.
We walk from Euston to St. Pancras.
So, but the liberating side of it is there's more space to travel for more holidays by rail, coach, cycling, and exploring those options. And a lot of people don't think of that, don't try that. And from the experience of my personal experiences, I think, rail holidays are a lot of fun.
the options for travelling to remote parts of Scandinavia
are now
less after the news that
yes.
DFDS are shutting down the what was quite a pleasant route, rail to Esbjerg and then the ferry and then a rail to a destination.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Well, we've been reported that the number of sleeper services in the Continental Europe are being axed on the threat. Deutsche Bahn have axed the city night lines from the last between Hamburg and Copenhagen.
I mean, Deutsche Bahn is quite a nightmare to travel on at the best of times. Yeah.
I think there's a behaviour issue around what you consider a reasonable distance for holiday travel. And you revise that and think, actually, it's going to take me 2 days by train, therefore I won't do it, and therefore I'll holiday closer. I think that's... But I think if you don't show some alternatives, and you can argue how palatable they are, I think they're quite palatable, then you don't even start that conversation about change. And I think what I'm trying to do is say, okay, If we map out what is consistent with that three terms, and we look at that and we go, actually, that's not too bad, and there are lots of benefits, and that's what I'm trying to do. That there then starts this argument where you can say, actually, that living a low carbon life, one that's truly sustainable, is a lot more attractive than I thought it would be. It's not going back and living in a cave. You know, there are certain difficult things to give up, like flying, but...
I suggest that my daughter should give up her job. She works as a geologist in Guyana, and either we don't see her at all, or she comes here...
But I think... this is the thing. It's like we've got the targets that Maria pointed to us this afternoon, this morning, and there are some very hard choices. And if we don't do them, if we're the people that are concerned, and we don't start doing them, what chance have we got to get anybody else doing them? It's kind of... But I recognise that people have personal circumstances that are going to be difficult, and what I want to do is give you an ideal and see, to encourage you to think, I can take a lot of that and use that. And lots of other people to do the same, and actually realise that there's a large chunk of this, maybe not all of it, but there's a large chunk of it that is actually quite attractive.
Maybe not sort of do it within your own economy. I'll turn up the lights, I'll wear sweaters for the whole winter if I get quiet to see you on Sunday.
That's the thing about when you start having the numbers here, is that you can start doing your own carbon footprint. I mean, there are carbon footprints, and then you see the balance. As I say, I mean, this is the summary of the transport options. Air travel, average, you're reducing about 1.2 tonnes. If you're flying 2, 3, 4 times a year, then obviously that's considerably more than you can say. Reducing your car use... So, against the average, 70% fewer kilometres, and you're sharing more often, you're using a small, efficient car, you'd say about a ton. If you're using a few kilometres and you've got an electric car running on renewable energy, then you can save a bit more. But your bus and train travel, you can expand. And you can travel 5 times further, and only have a small...
I mean, other people are, it doesn't come in.
Yes.
But yes, I have no car anymore.
Yeah.
Well, I was using it the last time I had it. I spent £1,500 on keeping a car.
And that's a quality of life issue. That is a real advantage for getting rid of your car.
Yeah.
So that's a real quality of life benefit from not having a car.
Well, I had that anyhow, but it's not that easy to go camping and win without a car, to be honest.
I had a dilemma whether to choose to get a 49 bus from Lancaster Station this morning, but I thought, are they reliable? I think although I'm fully able-bodied, I decided to book a place on the minibus, wondering if someone with less able body, that place I may have taken. So these sort of questions are going around all the time.
Yeah.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Stuart, if we move on to food, is the technology advanced? Because there was a slide in there showing the fast food store with photovoltaics on it.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, is the technology ever going to advance so that your car can run on photovoltaic? Solar panels.
That's in production. One of our sponsors, Keith Barnum, has just written a book called The Burning Answer, and he talks about the potential. He's a photovoltaics professor of photovoltaics, solar energy, and he talks about where the technology is going, and he reckons solar panels on the top of cars are not that far away. So,
watch this space.
Yeah. I don't know how far. Yeah, oh, range is the way, isn't it? But battery technology is getting a lot better.
Yeah,
a very interesting study was published a couple of months ago, done by researchers at Oxford University. It's the most comprehensive study I've seen that looks at diet and greenhouse gas emissions. They've collected dietary surveys of over 50,000 people in the UK of the various types of diets you see here. They looked at what foods they ate and they desegregated into over 90 categories. So it was more detailed, again, than I've seen in any other study. And these were the estimates of greenhouse gas emissions for different tons. So you've got a high meat eater, a mid-range meat eater, which is about the average for the UK as a whole, and then a low meat eater, fish eater, vegetarian, and vegan. And comparing the average with the vegan, you can save about a ton a year, and that's about half your emissions. And it's because of high methane emissions of cows and sheep for the meat, and particularly for the cheese, because cheese is a very intensive process. And also, meat being a less efficient product than plant products, and grain being fed to animals, grain that humans can eat being fed to animals, etc. There are complications around that, and I think we could discuss at length some of that. But in broad terms, there's a big jump there from at least going towards veganism. And then a variety of other options. Mike Berners-Lee, who's a researcher at Lancaster University, some of you might know, has looked at some of these other issues. He reckons a 25% saving if you don't waste food, if you eat what you buy. And food waste is a big issue. I think we talked about it this morning a bit. And that's kind of... If you don't eat many animal products, then you're already on a low carbon diet. And therefore, the amount, if you do throw anything away, it's got proportionately lower emissions. So that's inside of that. But food waste is an issue. Local and seasonable. He reckoned about 10% extra savings from that, and a few more percent from some of these other issues, other aspects.
How do you know that it's been food that's been produced in a greenhouse?
No, it's not labelled. This is one of the difficulties.
No.
It's knowing seasons of vegetables.
Yes. But even in the UK, we have to use them, don't we?
Yeah. It's kind of, the example that Mike Berners-Lee talks about is eating tomatoes from Britain in the winter. Don't do it because they're grown not only in greenhouses, but greenhouses that are heated using fossil fuels. So they're much higher carbon than actually lots of other foods. And it's better to buy tomatoes from Spain in winter because they're lower carbon than tomatoes grown in the UK. So yeah, it's kind of gives you an idea of different savings. Again, food is a complex issue, so some of these things are more complicated than that. The last of the four categories is kind of a bit of a catch-all. I'm going to talk now here about the things, okay, there's a section of your carbon budget that you don't have much direct control over, is through political processes. What can you do now that might affect that indirect stuff. And I've got a few suggestions and estimates around that. Some of them are straightforward, like switching to a renewable energy tariff, buying your electricity from a renewable energy supply like Good Energy or Ecotricity. That will produce some reductions. Buying less stuff generally. Things like buying a new car. 6 tons is about the carbon footprint of a small, efficient car. 35 tons is about the carbon footprint of a 4x4. Electric car, the upfront carbon footprint is estimated to be about 50% higher at the moment. And there's an issue around if you're running, and if you're buying a new electric car, running it off conventional grid electricity, which is still fairly high carbon, then the carbon savings are actually not that great.
I would say that the electric car actually uses more, has a higher carbon footprint than a conventional petrol diesel engine.
No, I'm saying the carbon footprint of building the car is 50% higher.
Ah.
Yeah. This is about buying less stuff, not about using it. It's about buying stuff. The carbon footprint of making things. And there's estimates of electronic goods as well. And we had a conversation in the previous session about clothes and whether people buying new clothes every month was as big as buying a computer. And I don't know the answer to that. But if anybody does, let me know. Two options that I think are worth having another discussion about. One is where you put your money, because fossil fuel companies can't drill for oil if they can't borrow money off the banks to fund their exploration projects. And if you're putting your savings or your pensions out of mainstream plans and putting them into things like energy efficiency or community renewable energy projects, things like the Ecology Building Society specialises in energy efficiency projects, home energy efficiency products. There's some of the schemes that we've talked about here are community funded. Putting your money into that, that can make, that's investing in changing the economy, and you're kind of using your money to shift where the economy is going in a more direct way. And that can offset some of the things. And then there's population with that. And having less than the average number of children is another option. So.
That was interesting, Maria, I didn't mention population this morning.
It's population is an interesting one, because population, global population for climate change is less of an issue because it's the high energy consumers in the West. It's much more of a consumption issue, and if you have less children in Africa, it doesn't make it any different. Whereas a biodiversity issue, population is more of an impact, and some things that Sue talked about, ecological footprint and taking up land area, then it becomes more of an issue. So that's when you get to some of the differences between total ecological footprint and carbon footprint. But if you're in a rich country and you've got the 12 tons on average carbon emissions, then that's a big way of reducing the contribution to carbon emissions. So I've made some estimates here, and you can come up with some pretty big numbers for these two. So investing 10k in an energy efficiency project or renewable energy project, if it's about £100 per tonne that the project is aiming to reduce, then you're actually enabling about 5 tonnes per year with your investment to be reduced, and that's offsetting all the indirect effects of your carbon footprint. If you're having one less child, well, it takes two people to make a child, obviously, you're responsible for half the emissions each, so 6 tons per person for not having one extra child. is another sort of offsetting thing. Putting all these things together, and I have a couple of combined options, and we can talk through how attractive they are, and I'm going to look at quality of life aspects of these. So combining some of the options to go for just under 3 tonnes. So you've got your super homes retrofit, making your house very, very efficient through all the extra insulation and solar hot water panels. And then your more efficient renewable energy electricity use, low use of a high efficiency car and sharing it more often, second-hand ownership, avoiding flying, bit of increased bus and train use, reducing your diet to low animal products. It's interesting if you look at the Zero Carbon Britain report under low animal products, they say, well, a sustainable diet could be one serving of milk a day plus one serving of other animal products a day. And that's the level that's consistent with their zero carbon products. At the Zero Carbon Products. Zero Carbon Britain report. So, and then not wasting food, and then being careful about not buying too much new stuff. And it's kind of, you've sort of got to there. And if you're doing some of the offsetting stuff as well, investing in low carbon energy, then you've more or less done it with this.
There is one problem that we are locked into the industries that make these goods for us, white goods, whatever, and have the built-in obsolescence with them. So I know that my products, kitchen products, don't last as long as they used to do. When my washing machine would last about 12 years, you don't expect those anymore.
Yeah, yeah.
So we've always got this circular problem of things breaking down.
Yeah, I think that this is exactly it. There's other things that have got to happen as well. And this is kind of what I'm saying is this is something like what we could be. And with a bit of help from the wider economy, which we shouldn't stop arguing for political campaigning, whatever, however you want to do that. But that's sort of, that's not an unappealing lifestyle, I think.
In some ways, it's not unlike, post-war UK, particularly I'm thinking of council housing. I was very impressed with the community laundrette that you've got on site here. But, before privatisation and on a housing estate that I lived on, they had a communal laundrette with the machines there, and that went to pots, so everyone ends up with a washing machine, machine in every unit, and of course the infrastructure of those buildings was never designed to take
that.
So you try and imagine what sort of public council housing would be like now with the input of that sort of agenda. You do get a sort of an ideal almost recycled as well. You know?
But it's kind of realising what we've lost, what we've lost from some of the things in the past. I think I'll show you my second option, then we'll come on to quality of life aspects. So the second option is the more radical option, which is about 1.6 tonnes per year. And that's kind of a lot of what at least some of us in Lancaster Cohousing are trying to do is got the passive house and the solar bioenergy heating, we've got solar panels and the efficient appliances and lighting, low use of an electric car or little use at all, car club, avoiding flying, some bus train use, and very low animal products and minimal food waste. A few possessions, you can kind of get it down well below three. And again, you've got the indirect stuff, so if you're investing in the community renewables project or you're having a first child, it's kind of... So I want to argue that there are lots of quality of life benefits from these two options. And I think that's what we need to demonstrate to the outside world, and it's kind of one of the things that we try and do in Lancaster Cohousing, is show that actually there's an awful lot of appeal to this. A highly insulated house, very comfortable to live in, low energy bill, less car travel. It's like driving in traffic jams really that much fun. Car club, when you can use a car occasionally, when you want it, somebody else does the maintenance. That's very appealing. Holidays by rail or by coach. And healthier diets. With the obesity epidemic, we've got a real potential there to move to healthier diets that fit in with low carbon living. And you're saving money because a lot of animal food is more expensive. And the sharing stuff is building community again. And the ethical investment, I mean, some of the community renewables, you're getting more money out of it than you can get in a savings account and maintenance bank. So what do you think? Does it sound better?
Good job.
Why the insulated house is so appealing. It's just incredible. If you've got I don't know, turn of the century, last century house with suspended wooden floors, 9-inch walls, sash windows. It's built to make that insulated. I mean, you can do roof space, but you've got an old house and you try to insulate it, retrofit it. It's a nightmare. And drafts. And of course, habitat for house sparrows. I mean, where do the house sparrows and starlings get in there? So they don't want my roof to get into.
What trees are in
there? No, not trees.
Just a quick question. I'll go to on each of the options that you have, what is the prospect of turning that into a new crop type survey questionnaire which can test across the UK to figure out what proportion of the population is actually currently living there, what proportion of the population thinks it will be able to do that, what proportion of the population rejects it as well, any incentive? I wonder if something like that.
Yes, that's a good
idea.
That's actually something worth suggesting to Sue, because I think that's part of what Bioregion does, is around. Jan, Vice Chair of SGR, psychologist, and she does surveys.
So you the results, you could then begin to make that case, which is all feasible.
Yeah.
The level of sacrifice, that's the first concern,
yeah.
Isn't it?
Yeah.
I thought that last week, or the week before, or both, in the New Scientist, the economists were now saying it was possible for this to happen, to get the emissions down by 2030, and still have a lift in your standard of living, and a better environment. Were they not sterling people like that?
Yes, I mean, they were the ones...
Does it not just need selling to people?
I think this is a difficulty Maria was talking to about some of the unrealistic assumptions and some of the assessments that say we can keep having a growing economy in the West, at least.
Was that just the West?
Yeah. Yeah, I mean, what Maria was talking about is if you make space...
Well, like Sterling is reporting, Ed Daly and people like that saying it's possible to happen.
Well, that I'd have to check.
That's straightforward.
Nick Stern chairs our centre, the Women's Centre for Climate Change at Leeds. And, people broadly fall into the... There are people who think that economic growth is not emissions. Mm-hmm. And Nick Stern falls into that camp. Nick Stern and economists, as are most of my colleagues at LSE. And there are people who recognise that you can't have infinite growth in finite climate. And people like Kevin Anderson at the Timber Centre, that's what they're proposing, that we have to move towards a lower growth or degrowth model, and move away from gross domestic products being a value of a thriving economy, and more towards well-being and other measures of prosperity.
But it seems to be a way to sell it to
people.
No,
but it's selling, but essentially, what essentially you're just selling business as usual and saying we can all just go on doing what we're doing and it will all be fine.
I thought we cut the emissions now rather than wait, so it will be all right in the future.
Right, I'm very interested in this.
Yeah, it's whether you think that the evidence stacks up that you can cut the emissions as fast as you need to and still have the kind of rates of growth 2-3% that we have had, and there are lots of people saying, well, actually we haven't been able to decouple economic growth from carbon emissions, and until you do that, all we're seeing is growth continues, carbon emissions continue. Until we can break that link, then we either have to slow growth or accept that we can continue growth, carbon emissions will continue to be upwards. So although he's the chair of the centre that I work for, I'm an academic in the centre, so I'm allowed to say, I didn't buy that model.
Well, that's policy, I hope.
Oh, yeah.
I also do contestant.
Can I ask you something on that?
I remember Chuck Conroy, who was director of Friends of the Earth in 1978 when the windscale fire was on. He characterised in the book that he wrote about it afterwards, he said there are people with worldview one and there are people with worldview two. The worldview one are technology is going to sort it, man's dominion over nature, onward and upward, and worldview two are those who maybe reflect, more club of Rome, more recognising limits of friends and so on. And he was wondering aloud in that book, in the chapter, as to whether they ever can, it was just a clash of ideologies.
Mm.
And then what's obviously what Stuart is trying to do is to say we can have our cake and eat it. And whether as an association ourselves, as SGR, whether we can actually be bold enough to say, actually it can be more fun, it can be, they will be better off if we do, if we nurture worldview two, or whichever way around, you want to have it, and that it is in so many ways better for us.
Mm.
And then that seems to be the question, because it's the question whether you have GM, we've got to have genetic modification to feed the world, worldview one, or well, actually, the world is feeding itself mostly by indigenous low technology organic agriculture. And the problems occur when you take people off the land, etc., 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 and push them around, and land around. So, what is it's a question for us as members of the association as to how we want to encourage Stuart and others to, and how we. I find huge value in the Economics Foundation Tax Justice Network and so on, which are looking much more at trying to fill out, looking at the values and frames of the worldview too, as a way which might be more resilient in the long term.
if you look at the big picture, most people can't afford to do a Holocaust retrofit.
Yeah.
And they don't have the knowledge either. There aren't the skills in the economy at the moment. It would require virtually the whole of the British building industry and subcontractors to be retrained on low energy retrofit. Most of the problem is in the old housing stock. The government always takes the easy route and says we'll build more houses, but they're actually now reducing the targets. For example, scrapping the code for sustainable home, never mind passive house. So they're actually taking the obligation away from the big building companies to build energy efficient houses as well as affordable ones. And you will only get the scale of energy reduction on converting the old housing stock into low energy through government intervention on a big scale. It require huge political change, huge social change to change people's ways of life. A few people, like the people in this room, can do a bit. It's just a drop in the ocean.
But I think I agree with you about the political change that's needed, that we do get it. I want to show a vision that we can broadcast more widely to say, actually, this is something that is really desirable.
Yeah.
and we want it, and government should make it happen.
Yeah, these figures are quite revelatory.
Mm,
it's all possible.
I think in the first place it'd be useful to separate the question of carbon footprint from the more wider issue of sustainability. As far as CO2 emissions are concerned, not only is there right, but the technology has moved beyond that part. We're now in a situation where, provided the most efficient technology is used, which includes, as far as well established technology is concerned, large-scale transport of energy over thousands of kilometers, which greatly enhances the effectiveness of local energy supply, local renewable supply. As far as that particular issue is concerned, it's perfectly possible to carry on while increasing GDP, but at the same time, say in 50 years' time, simply eliminating. Flying is another bit, it's a bit difficult to fly on renewable energy. I don't know now about that. Otherwise, it's not really a problem. That doesn't, of course, mean that there isn't a wider issue of sustainability. It does, incidentally, require a huge amount of raw materials, which are there. In that sense, are not sustainable. But what remains to be gained, of course, that if you keep throwing away plastic and whatever, then the environment is ruined.
Mm.
Even if you have it all made by renewable energy.
Sorry, say that not.
If you keep a throwaway society,
yes,
then your environment is ruined in any case.
Yes.
Even if you
throw
away stuff made with renewable energy.
Yeah, yeah, yeah. Now I certainly agree with that.
Papers come in because they want to buy.
Acronyms about the different systems and it's a nightmare because they're just fiddling while they're on birds and we just need to move to a situation where we have do we have more taxes on income and people's ability to pay and then to reallocate those funds raised to.
But there's the whole issue of ecological tax reform, tax pollution and energy.
Carbon free
they're breaking up next door, so I think maybe we're... Oh yeah, it's half past four. It's time to go.